All right, ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to Room on Fire once again. Of course, we're going to be ready here with another great evening of Counter-Strike, and we start off with OverGaming playing Titan. And as you've noticed, the music has changed because the Twitch terms of use has as well. That's just how it goes. No big surprise, actually. But, you know, we'll try and work with it, see what we can do. It's a lot of anger on the internet, but actually it's not really a big surprise. And it's not really Twitch's fault either, unfortunately. Be so great if we could blame Twitch and Google, but actually the people we have to blame are the people who hold the copyrights, who are trying to, you know, have us stuck in the 1990s, which is not really fun at all. That's just how the world works, unfortunately. Mandetra, I can tell that you're here with me, and I'm sure Semler's going to be joining any second. So how are you doing?
I'm doing swimmingly, really well. So, yeah, can't complain at all.
Yeah, I mean, we have some really good games on our hands just today here. I mean, the first one, Titan OverGaming, is going to be really hard, I think, for the Spanish team. They've been making a lot of roster changes, and that usually means it's going to take a while to really get up and running. There are some really good players in Spain, though. I think Musambani is the one that we all know, but I'm still waiting for Aguilar to get back in the mix here, because he was a very, very strong rifler. I would argue one of the strong, I mean, you could put him in like top 10, I think, of all riflers in Europe when he was really good in Global Offensive. So I don't know why he quit and I don't know where he went, but I hope he's going to come back eventually and play in the Spanish scene, because that'd be amazing. Apart from that, we obviously have Titan and virtus.pro playing. That's the next game up. Then we have Na'Vi and Hellraisers. So that's going to be a fun CIS type matchup. Really, probably going to be a bit of sparks flying there. Then we have Titan and Mousesports, which is a match that's not going to be very predictable, I think. And then we have Na'Vi and LDLC. So pretty much just a full evening of great Counter-Strike. But before we do anything else, I'll switch it over to the game and we can take a look at the players jumping around and stuff like that. And I will try and just explain to you the problem of copyrights and music for a bit, because we might as well talk about it as everyone else's too. So the really big problem is that, for obvious reasons, you can't stream music that people can then go and download afterwards. That makes sense, right? If we had, you know, if we made all the VODs available, cut out all the music and said, you know, you guys can download the music here, that'd be a big problem. But we've been using it exclusively as a live feature, basically, so that, you know, people can't go on the VODs and find it. And now Twitch has basically made sure that no one can ever do that, because they've muted all the VODs, so you can't hear the music. Unfortunately, they also mute the game, which means now all the VODs aren't working. And the real problem is that there is no legal alternative. There is actually no way that anyone can purchase a licensing to be able to broadcast music on an international basis on the internet. And that's just very sad to have to say, because obviously it's on huge demand. I would love to pay for it. I have no problem with paying for streaming music. I think it's a really good idea, and you know, I think everyone else will too. I mean, I have my Spotify account, which is, you know, one of those unlimited accounts for my personal use, but the business version of Spotify only exists in Sweden right now. You can't get in any other country, and I'm not even sure, even if you could, that you could use it on the internet, because I think the business version of Spotify is meant to be used only in a store, like in a physical store, where you have people from one country showing up, and not on the internet where you have people from multiple countries. Because the other problem with copyrights is that basically the people who maintain copyrights want to try and regionalize the internet, which is just a dumb idea, but they've been trying for a long time, and they're not going to give up, apparently. So that's what we're faced with here. Not really Google's fault, not really Twitch's fault either, in my opinion anyway. It's obviously a bit annoying, but ultimately it comes down to Sony and whoever else owns all the music in the world, basically. So that's the issue, put really shortly. Oh yeah, I should definitely remove the missed texture, right, guys?
Yeah, I was about to say. It's nice and all, but you know.
Yeah. It could be alright.
It might be, you know, slightly mixing signals, I guess, for people tuning in.
Yeah.
We're overwatching Musambani.
Well, you know, you never know. Maybe Kenny could get Overwatch banned here, or MBK has been playing really well recently. Who knows?
Yeah. It's very true. I'm actually so eager to see how OverGaming does, seeing how they have about as new of a lineup as you can get. Swapped out two members for Lowell and Mixwell, if I'm not mistaken. Or maybe it was Alex, actually, who joined.
Yeah,
a couple of days ago.
They've been switching up a couple of times, which makes it even more difficult to track. The lineup that's on SLTV right now is Alex, Kairi, and Musambani, Lowell, and Mixwell. So I guess Mason is gone.
Mason and Flippin.
Yeah.
Are gone, and Alex and Mixwell are the new members.
So, do you know any of these players from previous lineups in any version of Counter-Strike?
Yeah, absolutely. All of them, actually. Play with versus them quite a bit. Obviously, I even played versus them in Go, but that's starting to be a while ago. But I don't think it's really much of a downgrade, really. With Mixwell and Alex, at least the way Mixwell has been playing versus me online whenever I played him. So, yeah, I don't think it's a big downgrade of any kind. I think they managed to maintain Kairi and Musambani, who are, in my opinion, the best players on that team. So, I think they have a good base to work off of.
That's interesting. And, it would be kind of cool. Why can't we have a really good Spanish team? Do you know of any, like in the Source or 1.6, were there any? I know Musambani had a bit of a reputation in 1.6 as being a bit of a scary player, like the Spanish get right almost, you know, sneaking up and doing crazy things. But apart from that, were there any decent Spanish lineups?
Well, in 1.6, any decent Spanish lineup had Musambani in it. pretty much. Right. And that's not, you know, any diss towards other Spanish teams, because they were a legitimate top 10 team in the world at certain points. So they were definitely good. In CSS, you had a lot of Spanish lineups with the Aquila, Christopher, and those guys, and Torpe, and those kind of guys who did really well online, and the Spanish team did pretty well for themselves in Nations Cup and occasionally Euro Cup and those kind of things, but they never really had the opportunity to attend any real events. So they were okay online. They had the potential to... They were kind of like what we felt like MAU Sports were a couple of months back. So they had the potential to mess up for teams that we regard as better. But, yeah.
Oh well, I mean, so there's some room for improvement there. I like the idea of having a Spanish team, especially now that we have the ESC, the ESCC coming up, the European Championship coming up, which is, I think EFRAG are hosting that one, right?
That's right. And they've already started with the qualification rounds, I think, they have been announced, but they've got until the 19th to finish them off.
All right, so that was actually a lot of fun last time. I really like that because, I don't know, to me it seemed like it would be just random Counter-Strike and not very many people would be interested, but I was actually very surprised by how many people tuned up to cheer for their country, so we'll see if we can get involved in the casting of that as well. We were last time, I don't know if we can be this time. I haven't actually spoken to you, Frank, but I shouldn't. They're cool people, so if there's room for it, I bet we can. If there's not room for it, then we'll just have to enjoy and watch anyway. We do have a lot of stuff to do, so, you know, I don't blame them for keeping it to themselves if that's what they want. Now... We're just still waiting on Semler. I'm not sure if he's going to be joining any second now.
He's teasing us.
Yeah.
Fashionably late and all that.
Yeah, fair enough. He's going to join when he joins, you know, Semler. Well, he has, you know, special privileges in this context. Of course, you know, super excited as well to announce, now that we can actually finally say it, that Semler and I are going to be going down to Gamescom to cast with everyone else. Pansy and Tosspot and whoever else is going to be joining us. Richard is down there as well. It's going to be really a massive amount of fun, and I'm looking forward to it so much. And I bet we can, I hope, I trust we're going to be able to pull out players as they exit the tournament to help us do the color casting bit as well. Because as some people have noticed, there is an abundance of play-by-play casters in that lineup. And that's definitely true. So I'm definitely going to be pushing to get people in like they did last time. ESL... in spite of the rumors, are really not so stupid after all. So they kind of know what they're doing in this sense, I think.
Well, I'm not gonna go any further on that subject. But yeah, there is a plethora of play-by-play casters, and I mean, if we want to look at it that way, it's pretty good play-by-play casters as well. So that's a nice thing. That's a good thing.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to casting with Pansy again. I'm going to try and make sure that can happen. And
the Pandas combination?
The Pandas combination, exactly. That was very enjoyable. Yeah, actually, because... I don't know. I sort of always thought that that Panty needed, you know, time to work more on Counter-Strike. And before I went to cast with her at the Raid Call Cup, I always thought, well, you know, I think she just needs to focus on, you know, on this game alone. And obviously, that's really difficult at ESL because she does all sorts of things, which
yeah,
I actually have a huge amount of admiration for, because I probably could not do what she's doing. I don't think you could put me in just any game and make me cast it. I think I'd be very bad at it. The only reason I do this is because I really love Counter-Strike. And if someone came to me and told me, well, Anders, you're going to have to do, you know, Titanfall or something else now to make a living, I'd have a really hard time doing that. So
you can't really do games without recoil, can you?
Well, I mean, that depends on how professional you are, I think, and that's what really struck me when I then went to Raid Call, is that Pansy's actually just, like, a super professional, and she's very good at what she does, which, and it was so enjoyable, I really liked it, and since then, I've just had a lot of respect for her, so I'm looking forward to doing it again, and it's going to be great fun. And obviously with everyone else, I finally got to cast with Tosspot, and it's nice to have Semler and I at the same event. That's, you know, that's what we want, ultimately. The Room on Fire combo showing up.
That is true.
And then, you know, we'll do what we can. Maybe we can get you to an event as well, Vendetta. That would be amazing.
It seems like a current trend is that you have to have an English accent to get in there, so maybe I have to swap over. Who knows?
You can do that. You can do that. Maybe try something different. Why not go with, like, a Scottish accent or something?
Oh, I think Ren would be highly amused by that.
Well, Rennie is... Yeah, he's actually pretty Scottish, right?
Yeah, he's pretty Scottish.
He does. Like,
so Scottish is borderline Welsh.
He deep fries his food. He drinks iron brew. There's all sorts of sign.
I think he claims not to have a deep frying machine in his house, but I'm pretty sure he has one in his room.
Yeah, that's obviously lying.
Yeah, he's Scottish. We obviously have to have something. Yeah.
All right, well, look, guys, now that we've wasted some time here, we are ready with the first game of the evening. It's the Spanish OverGaming team versus the French-Belgian Titan, which have they've definitely improved a lot recently, Titan, which is really exciting because they are obviously going to be going to Gamescom. So welcome to Room on Fire. I'm Anders, with me is Vendetta, and probably joining us at one point is going to be Semler as well, as soon as he gets everything sorted out.
Actually, I just came to, you know, realize, isn't there a big storm going on in Sweden right now? Because I just read some tweets from Bruno from the Good Studio, and apparently their router had gone, you know, people's PCs were broken and all that stuff. So who knows, maybe, you know, it's just bad weather keeping him.
That could be, we'll see. I've, you know, either way, this first game is going to be of an interesting quality, I feel like. I'd love to see OverGaming upset us here, but I want to see proof that they can actually do it. If they can't, well, I think Titan, I'm not going to hesitate even for a second. I think Titan actually prioritize SLTV quite a bit here to try and see if they can make it through to the finals. Obviously, in total at the group stage, only four teams are actually going to make it out, and already Musambani's been found. Lowell running out of bullets. That's the problem with facing that many Glocks, and it's going to be down to Mix, who is down towards the boiler room, and he's going to get a quick headshot, but we'll be going down, and actually Alex is going to pick up Existence as well, and this has turned into a 2-on-2, so really nice shooting coming out from the Spaniards here. Flipping. Can he find anyone to connect with?
This is going to be a pretty hard retake. As long as Scream is able to stay alive here, I think this is still in Titan's favor.
Kenny is low on health. If they had a grenade, that would be absolutely magical right now. Scream up here, C-Zed's going to take down one, and now he can spend some time hiding. He's going to challenge with just three bullets. Yeah, it has time to reload, and the clock's so far ticked already. Flippin' is really running out of it. He's got to get this kill very quickly, and it's not happening. Just way too much time now. Spent. He's going to get the kill, but loses
the
round.
Channel this whole time, like, where are those guys?
As we predicted, not enough time here. So there we go, Summer. Oops. Welcome to the show.
Well, I guess that kind of Semler's entrance was equal to, or Semler's shenanigans was equal to what that round kind of played out to be. That was a lot of back and forth, and honestly, I thought Titan would kind of just stomp over them until Mixwell got that frag onto, I think it was MBK in the boiler room. And before that, it looked like Titan had full control, and it actually turned out to be quite a close round.
Yeah, so that was definitely interesting, and Scream playing it down to perfection there. What's up?
I'm not hearing Anders. Are you hearing Anders?
I am hearing Anders.
How are you hearing Anders and I'm not hearing Anders?
Do you have local mute on?
I shouldn't.
Some strange audio.
I haven't changed any of my settings, man.
Right. Let me try and reconnect. Let me try and do this. Why not? How about now?
I can still hear you, at least. I think the problem is on some side. Maybe Sam tries to hop in and out.
Yeah, I totally blocked out Anders, of course.
You did?
No, I didn't. I don't know what's going on.
All right, I'll try to relay whatever Anders said.
Yeah, well, we'll try and sort it out, guys. Of course, sorry about this. A bit of a weird issue going on with our mumble server. Not really sure what that is. Got Molotov raining in on two new boxes, which means anyone standing there is obviously going to have to be forced out. And we have Flippin covering the bomb site here with the C-Sed. And Titan have made the correct call, obviously, going for the B-bomb site. It's only one guy with the C-Sed. Does take down Smith, which is pretty incredible, but not quite enough.
And I'm extremely surprised. Surely they must have figured out that Titan was pushing in at that point. So, and still, they kept rotating towards the A-bomb site. They kept going further and further back into the A-bomb site. And now they're just going to save their weapons. Which I guess is okay, seeing how they have armor and CZ-75. Or what do you think about that, Sam?
I don't know what's going on.
I don't know what's going on.
I'm at a loss. I'm buried in mumble settings right now trying to figure out why the hell I can't hear Anders.
All right. Well, okay,
I hear you just fine. I hear you just fine. I just can't hear Anders.
This is the weirdest thing I've ever tried. Well, the round is going to end, and three people are going to try and save their armors here, which is a pretty good idea. They can use them for the next round. So yeah. We'll see. And yeah,
we're most likely going to see POVS coming in here. Actually, we are, because NBK disappeared.
Oh. Well, that's a bit of an issue. That's unusual. I mean, Titan, I'm assuming, are boot camping and everything, so
yeah, it wouldn't be an issue. So. Yeah, and you know, funnily enough, MBK was tweeting out just prior to the game start, you know, that there's a rumor out there's a rumor out about MBK, similar to Forrest being in jail, that MBK is in the hospital. So who knows? Maybe karma struck here.
MBK in the hospital. Forrest in jail. What else? I've heard all sorts of rumors about lineup changes and everything else these past couple of days, so I don't know what's happening, if there's just a lot of trolling going on, or if the community really is freaking out.
According to Existence, this happens quite a bit, so luckily it's not a serious issue. MBK is alive.
Well, that is good news, right? So yeah, I mean, the Spanish team going for some body armors and some pistols, pretty standard stuff. I do like the fact that they've invested into flashbangs as well. I really count that as a big difference right now in the teams. I think the teams that invest into flashbangs, even if they don't buy armor, but in eco rounds just buy a flashbang or a smoke or, you know, a little bit like that, I rate them just a, you know, a notch or two about the teams that don't, basically, unless they have a very specific purpose for not doing so.
Yeah, I think, actually, I'm kind of leaning the opposite way. I think if they have a specific purpose for the flashes, then I agree with getting the flashes. Similar to what iPower did last night when they had that wonky semi-buy, you know? I think they had Steel saving the M4, and the rest of them were on Eco, on Dust 2. And they did this NOA tower into an aggressive push into Lower Dark and all that good stuff. When they have set up strategies for what they want to do in Ecos, then I agree with getting the flashes. If you just buy a flash for no good reason, then I'd probably rather see pistol and armor.
Yeah, well, I mean, I think it's going to be interesting to see how it's going to unfold once we get to Gamescom, how teams are going to handle those things, because I do imagine we're going to see a couple of different variations of it.
I'm sort of expecting all the teams who actually win the pistol round to be the most passive teams on Earth the next two rounds, because we've seen so many teams lose their anti-ecos the last couple of weeks.
All the teams, does that include iBuyPower?
That very much so includes iBuyPower and Hellraisers. I think they're the worst culprits of losing anti-ecos, because that was unreal what we saw last night. I think it was 7 anti-ecos lost on 3 maps.
Yeah, that was quite devastating. And iBuyPower won anyway, so
yeah,
I don't even know what's happening.
Actually, that's pretty scary. If you're able to work with that kind of deficit or that kind of handicap that you put on yourself, then you're doing pretty all right for yourself. Because I think you mentioned it last night, if iBuyPower stopped doing those silly mistakes like losing anti-ecos versus Navi last night, they would have already won Dust 2 15 minutes before they finally did it, right?
Yeah. That's so what it felt like.
Yeah. And I completely agree with you. So that kind of tells you how scary they are. They didn't have the best showing at G3, but I think they're going to be really scary going into Gamescom.
I really hope so, because those kind of mistakes are ones that you can fix if you just sort of readjust your team a little bit and get their minds in the right place. And, you know, they just have to basically respect that the antique round is something that, you know, you have to play basically like almost any other round, which I guess they're just not used to. Kenny monitoring that corner, and again, I'm going to take full credit for that one. I called it out, like, what, 6 months ago, that people should use the Molotov to check that corner, because it's so easy. It's not a small investment, but considering how many times we've seen people die to someone hiding in that corner, I think it's a pretty valuable one to make. So I think I'm glad to see the team finally doing it. Flippin' coming out of the smoke over towards Archway, and is going to put a little bit of damage in. And from behind, Mixwell coming up with two great kills and takes the AK headshot. Scream! Wow! What did we just witness? Now it's going to be down to NBK alone, and he is going to be spraying full on. Takes down Alex, but it's much too late. What an insane performance from Mixwell. That was glorious.
And here we are talking about teams losing to anti-ecos, or teams losing their anti-ecos. And I don't think OverGaming could have dreamt of a better situation, really. They lost one guy in their eco round. That's crazy.
Just the one, and actually Mixwell was coming up from behind on MBK as well. He could have got a quad kill in this round. He stuck at the three, but that was incredible. And does take a little bit of, nerves of steel to... Well, the first two people with the Mag 7 come up from behind, but picking up the AK and then landing the headshot as well in that kind of situation, definitely pretty impressive. So 2-1 being the current scoreline, moving straight into the fourth round. The Titans, they actually do force it up here, which is... I don't know. This is interesting. Do you agree with this kind of force up from Titan?
Not really. But then again, it's not the biggest thing in the world seeing how they're doing it so early on in the game. I don't think this is something that's going to haunt them for a long time, because if they would have, they most likely would have had to double eco either way, seeing how Smiths, who didn't purchase basically anything, he's down to $100. So, yeah.
Yeah, they're going to be walking right through the smoke into the bomb site, and they will actually take down Alex, so that works out really well. Flipping in the backside over by the flowers is going to go down to Scream. Great headshot, and the spray from Musan Bounty is not going to connect with anyone inside the bomb site, so we have a 4-on-3 situation on our hands. The bomb goes down, and Smith is hiding in this corner, and really important for Mixwell to check it in. He's acting like he will, but actually now he's looking the wrong way. He spots the barrel, and he's going to take the kill, and goes for a second one. Existence will stop him. And Musan Bounty, the smoke just clearing. He has to get a quick aim here. Lowell is going to take down one player, and it's back into a 2-1-2, and they're moving into the bomb site. Musan Bounty, can he come up huge? He goes for the kill, but Scream will take him down, and Scream will hit a third headshot of the round, and Titan are going to win it with just the two AKs to start off with. So that was very nicely done, and Vendetta, I mean, you notice they didn't actually flash through the smoke over at the beat. They just walked through.
Yeah, just walked through and caught Alex, I think, off guard there. And that's definitely not something you can have happen. And I would count that as an eco, pretty much, even though they bought up from Titan side, because they didn't really have a lot. That's kind of similar to what we see people buy up and after losing the pistol round, right?
Yes.
Like C-sets and armor. So barring the two AKs, that should have been an easy round for OverGaming, but you know, credit to Titan for making the most out of it, especially Scream there, coming up with three huge kills.
Yeah, now NBK picking up a SG-553 here, as we can tell, which is interesting, but it's not really a surprise any longer, I feel like, with NBK, because we've seen him pick up all manner of crazy weapons, and actually this particular weapon is one he's been using off and on. I'd say mostly off, but he's been picking it up every once in a while over a stretch of time, so I guess we come to expect it. Lowell with an interesting boost up inside the bombsite, one that we have seen before and only seen it work basically once, which was yesterday. See if it can come into play this time again, as they are moving towards Archway with Musan Bounty trying to cover the ninja corner here, looking at the edge of the smoke. Flashes go through, and Titan are just walking casually in here. Musan Bounty could pick up a great double kill and try and fall back in time, and he will make it around the corner. So smart play from the Spanish team. Scream is going to go down, and it will be NBK with the COD rifle, as some people have termed it, in a 1-on-5 here. Musan Bounty's triple kill really making the round here, and it Mixwell is going to pick up a double kill as well. That was... does it feel to you like Titan are trying to mix some stuff up here? Because once again, they just sort of walk through the smoke. No running, just slowly, casually walking in there.
Yeah, I'm not really sure what their intention behind that was, and I also think they kind of botched a couple of their smokes. I think at least one of them was meant to go in towards Speedway for March, and it didn't, and that kind of gave Musum Bunny all the time he needed really to pick up those two first frags. The fact that he gets the third, you know, is obviously just gravy at that point. But yeah, that kind of stopped everything Titan was doing. And now they're back to eco. So this is just really back and forth.
A good compact little comeback here at the beginning of the first half here from OverGaming, which is nice. They get some money on the board. They didn't lose anyone the last round. And as you said, with Titan ecoing, it's a chance to get a little bit more building up for themselves. Not really the ideal situation for Titan if they end up losing somehow to OverGaming here. So close to a major tournament. Don't think they want to throw anything away or show any kind of weakness at all. Flippin looking through Archway and does get taken down by Scream. So this eco round is working out perfectly for the French-Belgian team as Mixwell is going to go down to the pit. And it will be Alex coming in. And I'm not really sure why he's... Yeah, picking up a rifle and running I think would be the best case right now. The best choice.
Yeah, and again, a team losing towards an Eno versus an Eco. I'm not sure if this is just like blatant evidence that pistols are broken as hell, which they are, but I also think teams are playing versus Ecos in a really dumb way.
It feels like it, doesn't it? And I don't know.
You get this recklessness kind of aura or over the team that's going up against Ecos. They're taking unnecessary peeks. If they would have played like the most conservative team on Earth, they would probably be fine each and every time.
You have a feeling that's the case, but that's what I said earlier. I think what we're going to see at Cologne is that some teams are going to be very well prepared specifically for the anti-eco situation, and the teams that can hold on to those rounds are going to be just you know, miles ahead of everyone else, I suspect.
Yeah, the winner of Gamescom is going to be whoever handled their anti-ecos the best, I think.
That could definitely be one of the deciding factors. Anyway, I absolutely agree. So we'll have to keep a close eye on how teams manage it in the upcoming days here. See if we can learn something about it. But maybe they won't be showing all that much. I mean, that is another factor here. Is that if you have methods of dealing with those rounds, you're probably not going to try and give too much away at this exact point in the game. Mixwell up here with a Mag 7, and they are coming for him right in the smoke, and he's missing the shot. He's going to go down. Unfortunate. Smith takes down Muzambani, and Lowell is now caught in little pit here, but the bombsite is lost, and I'm not even sure they should try and retake this one unless they can get a really easy early kill.
Yeah, this should be impossible. MBK still has a smoke up, which he just could put down towards Arch and basically shut off that entire area whenever he feels like it. So if you're Lowell at this point, I'm not really sure what you're hoping for, but you need to get out of there as soon as possible.
He's looking for a kill. He's going to pick up one and then try and run away, and he will actually make it. So sneaky play, but if you do sort of a risk and reward type of thing, I guess that was maybe still a little bit silly, because if he had gone down, then that would have been much worse for OverGaming than it would have been for Titan.
Yeah, especially because that reward he got there from staying back doesn't really do anything for him or his team. I mean, sure, he got 300 bucks, but that's not going to allow for him to drop anything for his teammates. And it's not going to make it so that Smith isn't able to buy up the upcoming round. So that's just a hugely unnecessary risk taken from him.
Moving into the 8th round, and right now it is a 3-round lead for Titan, looking pretty good here on Inferno in spite of a bit of a wobbly start from both teams as they were trading some eco rounds left and right. Now OverGaming, they did force it up this round. They want to try and keep Titan at 5 rounds, and I guess at this point if you're OverGaming, you're either going to go absolutely huge and start winning a lot of rounds, or you're going to crash out. So I kind of understand the logic going into this. I mean, how many rounds would you feel comfortable giving Titan on this map, man?
5 at most.
Yeah, so that's
what I was
thinking.
They're at
too.
The breaking point. Yeah, they're definitely at the breaking point up to this point. And that's kind of what you get, I guess, if you throw away easy rounds that you should win early on. Because I think they were doing an okay job by actually coming back into it. As you said, they had this mini comeback at the beginning of the half, and right now it's starting to escape them completely.
And Titan are gonna go for. The NIP variation of this strategy, where you have one guy over here and then four people pushing the B-bomb silent smiths, just has to stay alive and make a lot of noise as the rest of his team are going to push in right here. Flipping goes down, and Alex inside the bomb site in a really bad position. Does pick up the first kill and actually will get a second kill, which is very impressive. That was more than he could have asked for. And we're in a 3-on-3 with Musambani jumping up on the coils. That bomb not planted yet. Musambani takes the kill and then escapes into the smoke. Actual ninja play coming out, and Lowell is going to take down Kenny. So this is a very cool defense coming out from OverGaming. I think they came up miles ahead compared to what I thought they would here. Smith is going to get the kill on Mixwell, charges in and will go down, and that's going to be Lowell with the kill. And a bit of an interesting position coming out. Some screenshots are required. 5-3 moving into the 9th round. Vendetra, did you expect OverGaming to win that round?
No, I absolutely didn't. Musambani being, I guess, in a fortunate position, him rotating over so early really did a lot for OverGaming, simply because they denied the bomb plant, and that's obviously huge in that situation. I think Alex getting somewhat lucky getting those two frags obviously played a huge part as well. But that should have been Titan's round. Even like, as soon as they get those two entry frags and have the B bomb site, they should be able to get that round.
Yeah, I agree with that assessment. So that's yet more evidence perhaps that this OverGaming team has some actual potential, because they have been playing some cool rounds so far. Alex, once again, is alone on the bomb side, and they are actually going to come from him. This time, backup is really far away. Right now, if he could just stay alive, and if he can get a double kill as well, that's almost too much to ask for. But one kill or staying alive for a while is going to be helpful. They have him trapped, and Kenny, I think he saw the barrel of the gun, is going to be able to take him down. Now Flippin catches one guy jumping over the bomb. He's not planted yet, but it should be going down any second. There it is, but Flippin denies it. Really great play. OverGaming are using these smokes that Titan have put down very well against the French-Belgian team. So that's a real delight to see. Kenny is going to be able to plant for cover here, and finally it goes down, taking a long time. And now actually OverGaming have the advantage. Titan have a really hard time holding this bomb site down. Kenny, though, on health existence, has the most at 53 right now, and Scream is covering out on Banana where nobody's coming. So they need him to turn around and help out where it matters. Kenny is going to go down. It'll be existence next. Fall to Mixwell. Scream is in a 1-on-4. And that bomb is not in a good spot for him. There's actually nothing he can do at this point. He's going to pick up a good headshot there. A second one goes for the third, but the bomb is defused, and he's going to have to run away. So I'm impressed with OverGaming, I have to say.
I'm not so impressed by their initial defense, but their retakes are actually really good. And as you said, using the smokes that Titan put down to be a nuisance for OverGaming, they're actually managing to turn that around and messing up Titan quite badly. I was actually expecting NBK to hold on to that bomb for a bit longer, because, as you said, he kind of hesitated to do anything at the start. And, actually, it seems like Titan's pushing quite heavily towards mid here, so I'll get back to that point after all.
Yeah, they were at least, but now the smoke is up, and they're setting up in second mid. Actually gonna... Oh, they're gonna actually burn the bedroom. The room is literally on fire as Mixwell has to get out of there, or at least try and hide on the bed there. That could have been really scary, but now they might not check it, because they might not think he's here. In fact, Smith doesn't. So the Molotov that was supposed to kill Mixwell instead sort of works against them, because it gives them a little bit of false information, and now it's a 5-on-4. They realize Mixwell is up in his bedroom, and Kenny is going to be jumping in. He should be going down, but he will get the kill. And Existence is going to take down Flippin as well, so a bit of a turnaround. This is a strange round so far.
Really is. Especially the fact that... Well, I think they didn't foresee that Mixwell might get lucky enough to actually avoid the Molotov by a couple of inches. I think that more or less ruined everything for Titan. But there's still a man up, so... two men at that. So now it's all about Alex here on the B-bomb site.
Oh, great headshots coming in. You kidding, Alex? That's a quick triple kill. And OverGaming win the round anyway, with a great backstab as well from Lowell coming in. So Titan put themselves in a great position. They're two men up, as you say. One guy covering, and then he just kills every single one. And these are Titan members, usually not that easy to kill.
Yeah, and what's more surprising is that Alex, the last three times Titan have gone towards B, Alex has been standing in somewhat the similar position each and every time. So at a certain point, you have to expect Titan to anticipate the fact that he's using the same position over and over again.
You would hope so, right? They should realize that something's going on. And they did have that one round where Kenny was actively, sniffing him out in that corner, and that worked out great, but...
did not work. Fought. Yeah, did not work to let him roam around freely, I guess.
Good pick up from Musambani. Goes for a second one, and as he's falling back, he hits the headshot, and Scream is going to go down. It's a really nice management of the ammunition here in the M4A1. It only has 20 bullets, so killing three people is actually not that easy and can be a bit of a drawback sometimes for that particular gun. And Musambani will pick up the quad kill at the end here, so a really nicely handled anti-eco coming out from Overgaming. 6-5. They've right now won the last four rounds in a row, in spite of Titan having, at least for a couple of rounds, some very good starts to the game, or the round. Now we'll see if they can pick it up now. Kenny, is he going to pick up that AWP? No, he will not.
Interesting. Actually, Flippin is the first guy to pick it up, which is kind of surprising. Does have a pretty aggressive position here in Banana, and it might work out if he catches MBK here.
And I love the fact that they have Alex covering him, so if Flippin misses a shot and MBK sort of overcommits to it, he might be distracted. He's looking right here, MBK's jumping and misses the shot. Alex, can he help him out? He's falling back, and they both fall back to safety. But still, I like the buddy system, right? That's what we were talking about the other day.
Oh, yeah. The buddy system is, you know, worth its weight in gold, really. It's a necessity, really, if you want to play Counter-Strike at a high level.
Yeah, make sure.
I'm actually just really surprised that Flippin didn't get that entry frag on MBK, because MBK couldn't have given his position away more than what he did in Banana right there.
He definitely was telegraphing exactly where he was, so you're right, that's a bit unfortunate. A lot of noise and a lot of grenades here, and actually the bomb is making his way back to B. Musambani gonna peek out at the absolute optimal time here, taking down Smiths, and could have killed Existence too, but fails to get that shot. Now Alex has to cover from two angles, and he's gonna do something smart here, which is snuffing out Existence before the B push happens. That's actually a very clever play. Now he's gonna go down to MBK anyway, but he gets credit still for making that choice, because it's not an easy one to make in the, you know, in the heat of the moment, but that was definitely a good idea.
No doubt. Instead of, well, as you said, kind of just making it a 1-on-4, he makes it a 1v1, which is obviously better odds of succeeding.
It's a 2-on-3 retake. They're both coming in from the same angle, and Titan have definitely heard them walking in here, so we'll see if they can get something happening. Mixwell is going to take an insane jump over. Absolute madness. He is going to go down. I think that was, that was maybe more madness than it was brilliance at that point. If that had somehow worked, that would have been genius. But I think that was on the wrong side of genius, basically.
The wrong side of genius.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, I can definitely agree with that. That was a tiny bit overconfident, I guess. That's the nice way of putting it, instead of just calling him a madman.
Yeah, well, you know, sometimes you do have to do crazy things to hit that level of genius, but I think the problem is if you fail, then you sort of plummet into the depths of madness or insanity again, and I think that's what we just saw, unfortunately, here. Flashbang comes out, and Alex taking up on the car here. MBK dropping low, but will be staying alive for another second. He's actually on 41. And a little bit of a shame, you know, whereas before they had the buddy system going on where they could get the refrag, this time it just felt like Alex was walking out alone and there was not much Flippin could do to help him out.
Yeah, Flippin was not being a buddy in that situation. He was looking out for himself. And, well, I guess the result is kind of evident. Didn't quite work out for them. And now, I guess the worst thing coming out of all of this is not only being a man down, but the fact that they can't really safely rotate. They can't let Flippin be alone and B for a lot of time, because when that switch goes out, he has no nades.
Good grenade coming out here, Speaker of the Devil from Mixwell, but now things have gone from bad to worse for the Overgaming team, and Titan, if they win this round, they're going to force Overgaming to eco, and actually at that point, the first half here is almost gone for Overgaming. In spite of some really great rounds that they've had, I don't think Titan are gonna give up once they get to 7 or 8 rounds on the first half. That's just too much. This time it's Flippin, not Alex, who's been doing so well in this bomb site. Flippin's going to have to step it up here, and the Molotov lands on him. He's forced out, basically like a rat in a sewer. They're just trying to see if they can walk him out, and Flippin is going to go down. Mixwell next to fall, and the Musambani trapped in the middle of all the chaos.
It's actually a shame that Musambani couldn't get closer to the bomb site and maybe, just maybe, bring down the bomb carrier, because Titan waited quite a bit of a time to actually get that bomb down. I think it was 6 seconds left on the clock when they finally got the bomb planted.
Yeah.
So that could have done a lot for them. Obviously, that's kind of a, I guess that's where you go, you know, that might have been more on the madness side than genius, I guess, if you went for it, but would have been cool to see. But this is, I think it was OverGaming's only shot.
Yeah, I think so too, unfortunately. They're going to be able to save the one rifle here, which is kind of good news. But the bad news is everybody else on OverGaming just don't have the money to buy anything. It's Musambani and Mixwell currently carrying the show, but I mean, everyone else on OverGaming is actually doing well. There's nobody really, you know, badly underperforming. But they are playing one of the best teams in the world right now in Titan. And Scream is the one top fragging at 14 kills, which is, you know, not really too uncommon at this point, I think.
I think this is more Scream 6-7 months ago. And that's kind of where we want him to be. Because Scream, a couple of, well, that far back was just a different player than what he's been as of late, in my opinion. I think he's been quite underwhelming.
You're right, and he's been switching up his style a little bit every once in a while. Flippin doesn't get the kill, unfortunately, here, but I agree, Scream has just been, he's been stepping up quite a bit, and so has actually a lot of other people. I think Existence is steadily playing better and better, and we saw MBK a couple of days ago just being a real menace, so the whole Titan team seems to be coming together as one. I think Kenny's actually been one of the more stable players in the team, which was one of the things he was criticized before, you know, previously he was criticized a lot for that. So if the whole Titan team can sort of peak at the Gamescom event, well, scary things can happen.
Yeah, there's no doubt that their top level is just sky high. And as you said, I think that surprised a lot of people that KNS has actually been consistently the best performer from Titan. People probably would have assumed that would have been MBK. Yes. At least that's kind of what I assumed. But yeah, he's been doing a great job, and as you said, I just think it's a matter of the other Titan members actually peeking at Gamescom for them to do some real damage.
I suspect that is the case. Smith is going to go down. Musambani trying to carry the show on here, as he's been doing pretty much the whole time, but he's going to go down in the middle to Existence. So now it's Mixwell and Flippin trying to hold his A bombsite with just an M4A1 and a couple of flashbangs. Not really the ideal scenario for him here. And luckily, Titan are slowing it down a little bit, giving some time to Flippin to walk into the library. And if he can pick up a player here, the defense can still happen. But it has to happen now, of course. It's the final round of the half, and Scream's already spotted out Mixwell. Flippin going to get flashed out. They need to work together. And right now, they're basically completely zoned out from each other. No one can help here. Kenny gets a shot through the smoke. That's a dirty little trick coming out from Kenny there. And Mixwell in a lot of trouble. Does get the one kill in, but that's it. And now, Alex, it's going to be in a 1-on-3, so this is not going to be anywhere near good enough, I think, for OverGaming. 9-6 is definitely really far from the score they were looking for.
It's about 6 rounds away, I think. Actually, they probably couldn't let Titan get more than 5 rounds on the T side, and, well, here Titan are at 10, not at 9, so I think the second half is going to get really, really hairy for OverGaming, barring the fact that they might get the piss around, I guess. That might be the, I think that's the last saving grace, really, for the Spanish team.
Well, it could very well be. I mean, winning the pistol round might be able to make it back to a scoreline that says 9-9, and then at that point, it's still going to be an uphill battle, but obviously, there's always a little bit of hope, isn't there? So if you're just joining us, then a big welcome to the stream here. You're at Room on Fire, and we're casting the SLTV Star Series Season 10 match between OverGaming and Titan. We have a lot coming up for you guys this evening. All-Star Series, it's Titan vs. Pro next, then Hellraiser's Na'Vi, then it is Titan Mouseport, and then Na'Vi LDLC. So a great evening ahead of us. Remember, guys, we have a Facebook raffle going on at the bottom of the page where you can still participate in. So go and click that link down there, guys. It's really easy. All you have to do is like the page, and you can win not just this week, but the next 10 weeks. So definitely go and do that. Right now, it's a team group SSD drives, 240 gigabyte. Sorry, other way around. 420. Too much Twitch chat in my mind.
too much 420.
Too much 420, right? So 240 gigabytes right there. Go and like the Facebook page and you can participate in the raffle, and it's pretty easy stuff. Now going into the second half here, OverGaming. So talking about what might happen if all the stars align and they win the pistol round and maybe the fourth round too and all that stuff. On the other hand, if they lose this pistol round, then they will be just in a world of trouble. And I don't think I think this could finish 16-6 if Titan win the pistol round.
Yeah, I think that's actually quite likely. Barring Titan doing something silly and losing an anti-eco round. Which I guess we can't really close out at this point.
I'll give it like a 50-50 that they're going to do that.
Yeah.
Just, that's what it feels like. coordinated push coming out here. Bit of a timed aggression, maybe trying to catch Titan in the mid rotation. But they do have three people at this bomb site, which is might not even be enough here as Titan are dropping members. Existence with a really good headshot, but he's alone and running out of bullets. He's gonna go down. Too much for Titan here. Smith does pick up a kill, and Scream running in takes down the Bomb Hunter, and now it's a 1-on-2. Smith has enough health to do this, and just enough time as well, without the kit even. He's so close to the bomb site. Lowell is... timing to reload from Smith's, please.
Uncanny. He knows where both are, though.
Oh, are you kidding me? That was a great headshot. He's going to move up here. Lowell, one click from Smith. That's all it takes, but he runs out. And Lowell will pick up the triple kill and OverGaming win the round. Oh, that first kill from Smith, that was ice cold.
It really was. And you could tell that the OverGaming player who was in pit was like, yeah, sure, I can safely peek here. Because you can bet your ass that his teammate was screaming, don't peek, don't peek, don't peek. Just let him, you know, go at me, and you can take him while it's trying to get me down, you know, and just do the easy thing with the crossfire. And he just has that millimeter peek, and it doesn't quite work out for him. That was just a great shot. I think OverGaming got a tiny bit fortunate, actually, because I'm not sure if he caught it. At the very start of the round, MBK threw a nade towards quad, and it landed about 2 centimeters too short from hitting 3 OverGaming members who did not have armor. And that could have easily swung the round towards Titan, but I guess OverGaming gets that one round that they desperately needed, and now they just need to work off of it.
You're definitely right, and I'm debating with myself if we're seeing a Titan team that is, you know, not really firing at all cylinders, or if we're seeing an OverGaming team that's actually just better than definitely better than I expected, but...
I think it's more the first case.
All right.
Not to burst anyone's bubble, you know, obviously it's nice to see OverGaming give it, you know, bring it to Titan, but I think this is more Titan now playing as well as they probably should.
All right, fair enough. Well, the anti-eco is in effect, and already Musan Bounty's gone down. Will it happen again? It very likely could. I mean, this is just what it's been. For the last while. OverGaming sending one guy alone up in the apartments is maybe not the way to deal with it. Now they're going as a bunch, all rushing in here, just charging the bomb site, seeing if they can make it work, and it's working a lot better than it would have otherwise, I think. 9 seconds left, the bomb is going to go down here, but it's a 2-on-3 inside the bomb site. Flippin and Alex have to try and hold it down, and these positions are not good for the OverGaming team. They are not really able to help each other much, so they're fighting alone, but they will pick up the kills here. Existence now hiding right at the edge, trying to see if he can get a kill on anyone else here. But the clock is already really far down, and Flippin will pick up the kill. So, nicely done from OverGaming. What do you think? I was not a big fan of those positions, but I guess they were sort of forced into them.
Yeah, I don't think you can fault OverGaming, because, as you said, they were kind of trapped in there. I actually think the poor performance in that round was coming out of Titan in that 2v3. Or 3v2, I suppose I should say. But that should have been Titan's round. Smith's and Existence could have easily just overran the OverGaming player who's just caught at the very back in the corner without any problem. And actually, I think Smith should have gotten him just as a solo kill, but didn't quite work out.
Alright, so maybe more evidence that Titan are not quite up to speed here today. I mean, it could be the first sort of official match of the day, so I'm assuming that can also be a factor, and hopefully they are going to be fine up to deal with virtus.pro in their next matchup. That's going to be pretty important, I'd say.
Oh yeah, absolutely. I think if you don't bring your A-game versus virtus.pro, you're going to get stomped.
They do have a reputation, although the Polish team also were struggling in some of their matches, I think, yesterday, so... I really don't know. I don't think that match is basically a 50-50 in my mind. We'll see how it all unfolds. Existence up here, hiding, trying to look for a kill. He's going to spot a couple of people and should have definitely gotten one. And you could almost argue he should have pretty waited. And he's even typing in chat. Oh, no. Scream is going to go down as well, and he's definitely not pleased with that. Inside the bombsite, Smith is hiding, which is kind of cool, but I don't think actually anything will come from it. I'm sure OverGaming are going to be checking this. They come in, and they are going to spot him. He's going to fall to his death as well. MBK alone, and nobody dying for OverGaming side. So
somehow. Like, how did no one die? Actually, there, Flippin goes down. I guess he was the least likely person to die that round. Yeah. With the way things turned out. Existence should have had 2 kills. Easy as that.
Yeah, and it's one of those cases where, you know, the kills that are the easiest are sometimes also the hardest for some strange reason.
Oh, yeah. And I think that's what Existence is thinking as well, you know, evident by his rolling on the floor laughing.
Yeah.
Yeah, that, again, I think that would have been around that Titan, you know, a very good chance of actually getting. But even though they didn't, and obviously Overgaming equalized everything, it's a good sign going into the rest of the game for Titan, because they're able to bring it to Overgaming without weaponry.
That's true, you're right. These have been mainly eco rounds, so now we're at a 9-9 scoreline. The game has been equalized, and Titan obviously ending the first half on a 9-6 scoreline. That was on the terrorist side, so actually it is Overgaming fighting very far from behind at the moment. They have done some damage to NBK, which is good news, but I mean, Titan are playing this very defensively right now. They're, I mean, very, very defensive compared to what we sometimes see from Titan.
Yeah, and I actually don't mind this. I'm not a huge fan of their B setup as of right now, but I'm okay with them playing defensive towards the A bomb side, and especially against what Overgaming are about to do, which is seems to be a set B A strat.
And they have two people towards the quad side, so yeah, this is going to be a pretty strong defense, I think, especially maybe with NBK down here in the pit. M4A1 in hand, flash is raining, he's going to wait for them, and actually the flashbang works so well, he can't see a thing. Now they're going to jump down, but they do fail to kill him. Finally, they get him down there before he gets a chance to shoot again. Kenny inside, and the bomb is dropped, and it's going to be down in the pit. Alex trying to fight his way up with 10 seconds left. It's not a lot of time. Kenny being spammed through, and Alex picks up the kill, and he has enough time to plant. He's going to get the bomb down. Scream has to try and retake this. What a turnaround in this round. Scream looking to shoot through, but they're both hiding the exact same spot. Alex charges out. Flashbang again. Overgaming retaking this round. Scream's gonna pick up the one kill. Alex in the corner with the quad kill. Can he get the ace? It just takes one click here, and Scream is gone. Doesn't have to be a headshot, and he's moving up. Alex waiting, and here he comes. He's gonna pick up the ace, and what a round from Alex and Overgaming. Incredible play from the Spanish team.
I want to be excited for the Spanish guys, but I see how Titan are playing that CT setup, and I just want to face palm. That was so clumsy from Titan in so many ways. Smith's running out of library, just dying for no good reason, even though the two guys on site had enough control to actually hold him off inside a pit and from quad with no real threat at all. And then they kind of line themselves up really in an awkward way on site, behind the one box on that site that you can spam through, like stuff like that. It's just not a pretty sight.
No, unfortunately, I actually agree. They basically had four members in that bombsite, Titan, to deal with it. One was just coming in from Archway as well, so they should have been able to control that bombsite much more than they did. This time it's going to be a bit of a B push coming out, maybe from Overgaming. That smoke goes up and it makes them wait for a minute, which is a good idea. They have the time anyway, and Titan actually still have two smokes. Look at this, and Smith on Scream. So if Overgaming decide to wait on Banana until the smoke clears, they could end up losing the round because of it.
Yeah. With two smokes right here, this is gonna be... They're gonna have about 8 to 7 seconds to actually take the site if they're gonna wait out the smokes, and I don't think that's a reasonable thing to do. So they might have to go through the smoke.
They will have to. Smith's just there, picks up the one, and picks up an AK as well, spraying through Smith's. Oh my god! A complete crush! It's gonna be a quad kill and one for Scream. And the power of saving smokes has once again been illustrated right here. What a fantastic round, but also a round where Overgaming, I don't know, it's hard to say, but once you see that many smokes going off, you might want to think about, well, maybe it's time to go somewhere else.
Yeah, it's a death trap. It's simple as that. You don't run through smokes. It's dumb. And you saw that. That's an eco round from Titan getting a clean sweep. And you don't get that kind of result unless you're doing something incredibly stupid as the team with money.
No, unfortunately, that's just a mistake. Sole mistake you really can't afford to make here. I mean, the score is 10-10. Overgaming did not get a bomb plant that round. And because Titan were ecoing and they picked up a bunch of rifles too, they're in a really good shape right now, money-wise. And they're going to continue to press the issue. If Overgaming lose this round, they are going to be back on ecoing. And at that point, Titan are going to be pretty far ahead here. Scream with some really great headshots, including a little bit of spray. Going to go for another one and will pick up the triple headshot. All just all Haravich going on over here at the archway. Mixwell and Flippin, 2-on-5 right now, and not much of a chance to do anything. And that seemed like, I don't know, that seemed like a strange decision from OverGaming. Because if they want to go for the 8 bomb site, they can just smoke off Scream and ignore him. But they decided to go and challenge him one at a time as well.
Yeah, it seemed like somewhat of a similar round to what Titan did on their T side. When except Titan used smokes, but they did similar to OverGaming. They had nothing blocking the vision of whoever's in the speedway area, or yeah, the arch quad, I guess. So, and they both teams paid for it when it happened, and I'm surprised they haven't done anything about it. Just one casual smoke from the second minute area would just completely nullify anything that Scream could do from that position.
I do agree, and at this point, I mean, Scream actually ends up with a quad kill as well. He got the last one, another headshot coming in, so Scream is on fire today, which is good news. 22 kills and 13 deaths, definitely doing a lot. Now they're going to try and push aggressively down the middle. Titan wants to catch OverGaming off guard, and they are definitely successful in that. It's a very classic Titan thing coming out here, something that we've seen virtus.pro do a lot too. The Polish team tends to use this kind of aggression just when they feel like, okay, the other team's probably going to be ecoing, let's just destroy them, give them no chance. And actually, I like this idea a lot. So it's a really quick round, and we're at 12-10, moving into the 23rd round.
Yeah, I definitely like it when you have planned out aggression against ecos, similar to what virtus.pro pretty much do it on every map. So, and they have a really high, I think they're one of the best anti-eco teams in the world, so you can't really fault teams for trying to copy them.
Well, definitely not. That'd be a good start if you could just do that. Say, what does virtus.pro do? How do they stay alive? And then do what they
just,
do.
Yeah, they just run as a huge group and kill people on their turf.
The Polish death ball.
Yeah, pretty much.
Smith's over here on Banana, just looking for some shots through the smoke, and on the other side, Flippin's doing the same, and Wolby Smith's coming out on top. That stuff always looks a little bit ridiculous, but obviously they are well-practiced in those angles. Everybody knows them. So, and if you're playing matchmaking and you're not, you should go and practice, because it's worth knowing those angles. Muzambani coming in with a great headshot on Smith, so make it look easy. So a quick return, and we are off into the 23rd round here. Flashbang over, just trying to delay OverGaming a little bit, and actually they're already pretty far delayed. There's still smoke being used, I think. Was that over by the B bomb site? Yeah, no, it wasn't. That was actually by
A.
Scream is kind of alone, and that I think that's why he's getting backup as well. I think if he had another smoke, they'd probably leave him there.
They definitely would have had the opportunity to do so. They can't really do that now.
It is Scream, and he's going to be spraying instead of tapping, so he goes down. Does hit a headshot, but not quite as effective this time, and it's a 2-on-2. Bomb will be going down. Muzambani with a plan, and OverGaming actually have the health advantage. Existence coming in through construction, and Muzambani sniffs him out. Going to get another headshot. That's a triple now for the Spanish player, and NBK is in a pretty bad spot. I'd say almost unwinnable spot. Going to try and flash out here. Muzambani, easy quad kill for him, and it's a very, very nice round from OverGaming. The Spanish team is definitely not going to give up. Right now, Titan need to come up with something different, or they could actually end up losing this game.
I think the big game changer right here is the fact that Kenny has picked up an AWP for the first time in the game. And Existence as well. He has picked up an auto sniper, and he definitely knows how to handle that weapon. So, I guess this is the first real test for OverGaming right now. Now they have to adapt. And the question is, will they be able to do it in time?
Not easy at all, but the way the setup is working out right now, Titan just aggressive on Kenny here, actually trying to force them as much as he can to go to the A bomb site, where we have four people waiting. Of course, we can look at the minimap right here and see how it all works out. And OverGaming are playing very cautiously. This is almost incredible to just look at how far back on the map they are.
Yeah, I don't blame them though. This kind of reminds me of how people used to play the T side on Inferno, and actually how a lot of teams actually practice on Inferno, just taking their time, making sure they're not getting, you know, or going down a man or two to some aggressive shenanigans from the CT side. And you know, it also gives them time to see if they can get any free nades off of Titan, and then eventually they'll go in towards the set strat, most likely towards A. And I wouldn't be surprised if we saw the quad push we saw earlier on from them.
Oh, but MBK, no! He looks the wrong way crossing the road. And LOL is going to take him down. That could have been massive. Existence with the auto sniper is going to drop one, and Scream is still inside the bomb site waiting. So this push from OverGaming is now very delayed. 15 seconds, the bomb is dropped out on quad, so they need to pick this up, put it down very swiftly, and Scream is still inside. He's going to take down Alex, and that might be it, but they come around and take down Scream. How did Kenny die? Looked like he was covering the other angle. I completely missed that. OverGaming take the round. Vendetta, what is going on with Titan right now?
Silly deaths and bad choices. Pretty much. They're playing like teenage pregnancy right now. Just full of bad decisions.
Just full of bad decisions. That is a pretty bad, a pretty terrible analogy. Oh god, can you hear me, Samla?
I don't think you can still, I just caught that.
We're still not sure. For some reason, Semler can hear Vendetta just fine, and Vendetta can hear both of us, but Semler can't hear me, and I can hear Semler, so there's definitely something weird going on.
We'll get it sorted out, though.
OverGaming have tied the game. Yeah, we'll definitely sort it out eventually, guys. One of these days, it's going to work just fine. 25th round, and Titan have to start winning right now. Both teams actually cannot afford to lose.
Yeah, and Titan have realized that they need to win now, because they've bought up. That's a force bite, and not even getting head armor on Existence and Scream. Well, actually, most of them. Smith is the only one with head armor. Obviously, it's not going to matter as much, seeing how they're going up against AKs, but that kind of just tells the story of how broke they actually are. And I like this from OverGaming. As long as they don't split up.
Which they kind of are. Scream could have almost got to kill them, but now making some noise, they know exactly where he is, so that works out in favor of them, and they hear him running back to the B-bomb site, which may be an indication why they're going towards this A-bomb site instead, just thinking, alright, one guy is leaving, there's a great flashbang, and NBK with absolute ease gonna pick down two people like that. That was... That flashbang, I mean, even if that flashbang cost them $4,000, it would still have been worth it to throw it. And now, Flippin' and Alex are left here, 2-on-5, time running out as well. Alex goes down. God, that was an absolutely beautiful flashbang. It's not often we get to see one that's that perfectly timed.
Yeah, that was stars aligning for Existence and his nade right there. And as I said, initially, I liked what I was seeing because they were moving as a trio up Arch and had plans to go in towards the CT spawn. Which is perfectly nice. If you can actually get past that Arch area and into CT spawn, your odds are you're probably going to take someone from the B site off by surprise in some sort of way. And it makes a B split really easy to do. Instead, they split kind of up and they go one by one as they move back towards the Arch site. And, you know, then the godlike flashbang comes out from Quad. And that's the end of the round for OverGaming.
Yeah, the power of just the one flash there made a big difference. 13 to 12 is what we're looking at here. And, I mean, at this point, with the VODS Pro game coming up very soon, guys, just remember it, you know, right after this one, we'll have something like a 5-minute break and we'll wait for the players to connect in, and then we're going to go right into the VODS Pro match. And I'm expecting that, I mean, do you think Titan are going to want to play Inferno against that team? Against VODS Pro, that is. Because I can't make up my mind. Oh. Did we drop more people from the mumble?
Hello?
Oh, can you hear me?
Yep, I can hear you now.
Oh, so we have just weird disconnects going on. I'm not sure what that is. Now let's see. Kenny's up in the graveyard here. It's going to be MBK, and actually there's a big stack going on for Titan here at the A-bomb site. And finally, Lowell falls. Flippin' is alone in a 1-on-4, trying to escape the madness and all the bullets raining down towards him. And he's going to make it out with 20 HP, which... Well, it's going to be a matter of time. What's the best case scenario here for him? I mean, I guess he's looking for exits.
Yeah, that's pretty much what he can do at this point. He has to look for exits one way or another. I'm not sure if Titan are going to let him escape, though, because they know how bad the money situation is for OverGaming at this point.
He is going to be able to hide in a corner until the clock runs out, just barely. Some shots being put through, a little bit scary then, but 14 to 12, moving into the 27th round. So now you can hear me again. How do you feel about, VODS Pro Titan? Do you think they're going to be ending up playing on Inferno the way Titan are playing right here?
I don't think VODS Pro would mind that. With the way Titan are playing right now, but... Yeah, I don't see that as being impossible, and who knows, Titan... We've seen that Titan have made quite a few mistakes already, so maybe they want to go have another go at Inferno just to see if they can sort it out, really.
using it for practice or something like that. Seems like Titan are finally woken up here, as they do have a bit of an almost flawless round on their hands here. 2-1-5 and looking to make it match a map point. So OverGaming have come pretty far here. But if they lose this round, they will be utterly out of money. And it's going to be, I don't know, very nearly impossible. But I still feel like, I don't know, we've seen a strange version of Titan today with Scream and Kenny doing really well. And actually, it's not like anyone is really underperforming. It just seems like as a team, they're making some bad decisions.
Well, they really are. And I guess that's why we're getting that impression. But I guess it could be one of those games for them in many ways.
It could definitely be. And Mix in the middle. Mix well, going to pick up a couple of great kills, but there are just too many people left, and it's going to be 12-15. No money to buy much of anything here at the 28th round, where the scoreline is 15-12. Match and map point for Titan, and we'll have to find out. It could also be, I suppose, that Titan have been spending a lot of time focusing on the teams that are going to be at Gamescom, and now they're playing a Spanish team with a new lineup that they're not used to playing, so maybe everything is just a little bit off for Titan. Do you think that could be a reasonable explanation? I mean, maybe not the full explanation, but a factor anyway.
That could definitely be a factor. Not knowing what your opponent's tendencies are a lot of time can obviously throw you off, and it's a huge advantage if you kind of have a feeling as to what your opponents are going to do. So, could definitely play a big part of the picture.
Flipping down to 11 HP and one Galil and some CSET 75s. Well, I mean, they are CSET 75s, so Titan have been losing a lot of anti-ecos this game, just like OverGaming has, just like everyone seems to do these days. So I wouldn't count it out that they can win with them, but at this point it's looking increasingly difficult. And I'm pretty excited to see what the map's going to be between Titan and virtus.pro, because that game is coming up right after this one. It's going to be a really quick break. We are a little bit over schedule, because this one, I think, went... it's been a really close game so far, surprisingly. They're going to go towards this bomb site where Smith is hiding in the corner, and backup is actually coming pretty quickly by. Scream is running to try and see if he can get there. The smoke just went down, and they are out of smokes here, but the timing that's left here, I mean, 25 seconds is just not a lot of time to get into a bomb site. If that bomb goes down anywhere along the way, that's a big issue. And here they come. Smoke is up. Are they going to try and plant right in the front of the site? That looks like a smoke that's meant to be planted in, but they're not doing it much yet. There's a kill from Smith, and now they're going to go for it. But Musambani, oh my god, he stays alive, and he's finally going to put the bomb down here. It's a 2-on-3, now a 2-on-2. Flippin' and Lowell have to try and stay alive here if they want to fight the draw somehow, see if they can actually get it done. Lowell in the back and flipping inside construction. That bomb is planted in a pretty good spot. Should be easy for Lowell to guess the angle. MBK already jumping up on the barbecue, and Lowell buying a lot of time in the back. He's going to go for it. Plays down one, and now assistance coming in. In a one-on-one, picks up the rifle, goes for the kill. He's going to pick it up and turns around and has enough time for the defuse. So the good game is called. Very nearly made that round work, but not quite. 16-12 is going to be the scoreline.
Yeah. Right. Titan managed to squeak out a win. I wouldn't say it was impressive display from them by any stretch of the imagination. I definitely think they need to pick it up if they want to pick up another one versus virtus.pro.
Yeah, and that will be our next game coming up, guys, so do not go anywhere. We'll have a really quick commercial break, about 3 minutes, and then we'll be right back with virtus.pro and Titan.